Life cycle view of materials. What is a product or material life cycle? What happens at each step within the life cycle? And why consider the life cycle in the design process? These are the questions that we're going to consider in this video. All man-made objects are made of materials. Oftentimes, when engineering a product, we think only of the design space defined by the manufacturer of that product. Our system boundary is around the manufacturer step. In System A, the designer would be focused on the manufacturer step. The resources and emissions would be outside of the things they were concerned about. This leads to the situation where, for example, a designer may specify the combustion of coal to produce energy. While the design goal is achieved in this situation, what goes unnoticed is that the combustion of coal requires a mining process that can be very detrimental to the ecosystems, and the combustion process emits biotoxins to the air in the region of combustion. So, while the energy is produced, there's also a number of negative consequences that are outside the system of things that the designer is concerned about. A holistic view would consider not just manufacture, but the entire life cycle. For system boundary B, all steps of the life cycle, material, production, manufacture, use, and disposal, lie inside the system. As in the case of A, there are externalities associated with system B. What if we include system C as the boundary? In the case of System C, both the resources and emissions associated with each stage of the life cycle are in the boundary of things that concern us. So this example shows that by moving the boundary of the system, you can see that the things that concern us change. The system boundary really is a concept that we invent and impose on what we call reality. Here's another look at the notion of moving the boundaries. In this image, the boundaries are created by space and time. The smallest boundary would be drawn around a product lifetime and aimed at what occurs as a source. This is the approach of pollution control and prevention. Expanding the boundaries to the next level would focus on process. This approach is the approach of design for the environment. The next level of expanding the boundaries would examine the relationship between the industrial and natural system and look for opportunities for synergy. This approach is called industrial ecology. The next largest level considers the health of biosystems and social systems. This is the realm of sustainable development. Let's take a closer look at the life cycle itself. At each stage of the life cycle, resources, natural feedstocks, energy, and water are used, and waste, or byproducts, heat and toxins are emitted. For clarity, this detail is only shown on the material production stage. The reddish circle following the disposal phase is meant to indicate a recycle stream. What we recall is that in a closed thermodynamic system of the Earth, all of the extraction and emissions take place on Earth. You may recall the three R's: reduce, reuse, recycle. In the life cycle, the three R's look like this. The biggest impact is reduce because it decreases the inputs and outputs of all the subsequent stages in the life cycle. The next biggest impact is typically reuse for the same reasons. The least systemically impactful is recycle, or more realistically, downcycle. Recycling also requires additional energy inputs and is at the end of the life cycle, so has less potential for impact in the whole life cycle. Notice that the three R's focus on the environmental consequences. In the next video, we'll take a look at approaches to quantifying and reducing the life cycle impact. The life cycle includes four main stages: material production, manufacture, use, and disposal. Each step has associated resource inputs and emissions. A holistic consideration of the impact would include the entire life cycle. In the next video, we look at assessing and reducing the life cycle impact.